Hello everyone, I hope you are doing well. It's already Christmas season in many parts of the world, and soon many of us will begin our holidays. Some people ask me about how I celebrate this season. Well, to a large extent, Christmas in my region has become a traditional celebration instead of a religious one. Before moving to Canada, I knew about Christmas only through TV and movies. Back then, I was under the impression that people who celebrated Christmas believed Santa Claus to be a real person living in a cold area and that it was his job to deliver gifts to children. I thought it was very naive of them. It was only after I moved to Canada that I realized what I assumed in China about people's belief in Santa Claus was totally wrong. In fact, I was the one who was naive back then, because I mistakenly perceived others before knowing them. After moving to Canada, to respect and participate in local tradition, and also to celebrate this occasion with my family, I started decorating my home with a Christmas tree. But a couple of years ago, I stopped doing it mainly because my children told me that they didn't really mind either way. But for this Christmas, and given the terrible time we have all had this year, I will buy a Christmas tree to bring some warmth and joyous feelings to my family. The current lockdown has negatively affected everyone's life. By the way, I'm not suggesting that everyone to buy a Christmas tree. Of course, it is totally up to you whether or not you buy one. What I'm trying to say is that we should all try to find some positive elements in such negative times. I would like to remind you that two Saturdays ago, I posted my first Q&A video. I plan to post Q&A videos on a monthly basis, and I welcome all your questions on the internal styles, Xiu Dao as well as general Chinese culture. I may not have sufficient time to answer them all, but I will choose some typical questions, particularly those that are widely misunderstood or those that require more attention, and answer them for you in a video format. Today's video is the sixth video in the Decoding Martial Proverbs series. Like I mentioned in the very first video of this series, it is very hard to choose proverbs that are commonly misunderstood in the community. Different practitioners at different levels require different types of knowledge, and this is often presented in a proverb format. So, one of the objectives of this video series is to clarify some common mistakes caused by misinterpretation of popular terms. However, I don't think this approach alone is sufficient because some proverbs are not that very well known in the community to begin with. In today's video, I will introduce a couple of proverbs that are not so popular but are very important in practice. The first proverb is 前降后升, or downward from the front and upward from the back. The second proverb is 分宗射箭, or parting the horsemen and shoot the arrow. Also, I will provide a small demonstration to help you understand the second proverb better. Again, both of these proverbs are considered secrets by many martial artists. The first part of the English translation of the second proverb, which is Parting the horse man is very popular among Tai Chi practitioners. But let me tell you, the original Chinese term of the movement that you are thinking of is actually 野马分鬃。Do not confuse 野马分鬃 with 分鬃射箭。I'm very certain most of you have never ever heard about these two proverbs. So that's why I'd like to share them with you today. Some community members, especially those from China, have asked me why I share this type of information with everyone. My answer is very simple. First of all,My objective here is to promote authentic knowledge, and there's no need to hide any so-called secret at all. Also, sharing so-called secret knowledge alone is not sufficient. You have to put this knowledge into physical practice, or else this knowledge is useless. So,As long as more people understand the correct path of practice, I would be very happy. So let's get started. The first one is 前降后升。前 means front or vertical side of the body. 降 means downward. 后 means back or dorsal side of the body. 射升 meansUpward. Together, it means downward from the front and upward from the back. It is a very popular proverb in Xiudao practice. However, is it a popular martial proverb? Well, not at all. That is why I will talk about this today. In the context of Xiudao, I introduced this concept in a video about.Zhou Tian. In that video, I mentioned a practice in Xiudao that is the most popular method used to refine the energy, in which the energy moves downward from the vertical side of the body or the chest and the abdomen, and moves upward from the dorsal side of the body or the back.This activity is repeatedly practiced in Xiudao. Of course, there are different directions of energy flow in the body. But the most popular and fundamental practice to start in Xiudao practice in most of the Daozi school is to follow this method. Please watch my Zhou Tian video, link is in the description.By the way, some community members asked me about the direction of energy circulation in the body, probably because many of them were taught that energy only follows a fixed routine in the body, such as moving downward from the front and moving upward from the back. In reality, that is only partially correct.There are different energy circulation patterns used in Xiudao, especially at a certain level. Practice of different directions of energy circulation is necessary. I have talked about this topic in my Xiudao videos, so I suggest you check those out if you are curious. So, why is this proverb not popular at all in martial practice?Well, the answer is very simple. Many people do not differentiate the movement of the front or vertical side of the body from the back or dorsal side of the body. Especially in the Chinese styles, people always emphasize the concept of relaxation. Unfortunately, the definition and interpretation of the term relax varies according to the level of individual's practice. Naturally, people think that to relax, the whole body should sink downward, which is only partially correct. However, after reaching a certain level in practice, the whole body's sinking motion or thinking feeling alone is insufficient. Then, what is the complete correct practice? This proverb, 前降后升, provides the answer. Let me explain. In some classic martial documents, there is a common term which is 空胸下气, or empty the chest and sink down the energy. Actually, this popular martial proverb emphasizes the motion of the chest, including energy of the chest should sinking downward. Then, how about the back? Well, I explained a proverb in my previous video, which is 含胸拔背, or empty the chest and extend the back. This proverb tells us that the back should extend in different directions. This proverb emphasizes releasing the force in the horizontal direction. Again, the term horizontal direction here implies the overall alternate sideways expanding and the contracting motion of the chest and the back. If we want to talk about the force in the vertical direction, then what is the relevant proverb? Well, there is a better proverb for it. It is 后背提进, or energy raises up from the back. Let me explain this proverb now. It is not a very well-known martial proverb. Actually, only a few martial documents have mentioned this term. One of those is the Yin Yang Ba Pan Zhang, or Yin Yang Eight Area Palm, written by Ren Zhicheng in Tianjin about 100 years ago. In that book, he used the term 后背挺进 to describe the principle of the back, which is that the energy in the back should move upward, while the energy in the front moves downward. This is the proverb used to describe the vertical direction of the movement of the energy. You may say that you have never heard about upward movement of the back in martial practice, or many of you may think that you only heard about the downward movement of the upper body. Well, you are not wrong at all, because the downward movement of the upper body is emphasized in the relaxation process in martial practice. It is a static approach. It is the process where the body relaxes itself and returns to a neutral state. But the downward motion in the front body and the upward motion in the back is usually to describe the dynamic state in practice. When your teacher teaches you martial art, most of the time, they teach you the rules or principles based on the static state, not the dynamic state. Please think about it, and then you will realize that what I'm talking about now. While teaching, it is much easier to teach the principles based on the static approach, and it's only at an advanced level that the teacher will emphasize the dynamic state by using the right approach. So, I prefer to use the combined proverb 空胸下气后背提进. Both sentences should be used together to correctly explain the concept. But then, is this sufficient as it? My answer is no. That is because it is still lacking in specific guidance about actual practice. To help my students understand the practice better, I created my own proverb consisting of three sentences. So, the new version of this original proverb become 前降后升，降以呼吸，升以提领。The sentences 前降后升 remains the same as before, which translates to downward from the front and upward from the back, originally used in Xiudao practice, and I use the new version to describe the martial practice. 降以呼吸 means that the downward motion of the front or vertical side of the body is achieved through breathing. 升以提顶 means that the upward motion of the back or dorsal side of the body is achieved through rising up the top of the head. Regarding the downward motion of the front side of the body through the breathing concept, I introduced in my prior video that in martial art practice, the breathing actually should follow the body movement. Especially, we use exhalation when releasing the power. So, when releasing your power, you will exhale and push energy downward with your body. More precisely, most of the time, the front side of the body, including the chest, stomach, dantian area, should all sink downward. This is the principle of 降以呼吸. In any martial movement, there must be an upward motion before a downward motion or vice versa. So, 升以提顶, which translated to upward motion is achieved by rising up the top of the head, is used as a principle to describe this practice. Please keep in mind that in the future, you should not only emphasize the downward motion, but also pay attention to the upward motion. And the upward motion is done mostly through the upward motion of the back.This is the key principle of practice. Let us delve a bit deeper into this. To practice this method, you can start by focusing on the downward motion of the front side of the body while executing a Faji movement, then focusing on the upward motion of the back side of the body in preparing for a Faji movement. In the end,you should be able to execute these two more motions simultaneously, which is a higher level of practice. So far, I have explained the importance of the vertical movement and how to practice this by elaborating the proverb 前降后升降以呼吸升以提顶 I suggest you pause this video here and give it a try.Examine and verify for yourself if it makes any difference to your practice in terms of subtle body movement. To summarize the first proverb, 前降后升, originated in Xiudao to describe the vertical body motion. It is used in a martial context as well, but it does not sufficiently describe the correct martial principle.To sufficiently describe the correct martial practice, I added two sentences to this proverb, which now becomes 前降后升降以呼吸升以提顶 Again, this term is used in a dynamic approach, not in a static one. Now, let's move on to the second proverb, 分宗射箭 Part the horseman and shoot the arrow. I'm aware that the first part of the proverb is very well known as the name of a movement to most Tai Chi practitioners. But let me tell you that the complete proverb is very rarely known and nobody has publicly introduced it, not even in China. Only a couple of the senior masters whom I knew mentioned about it.I did a lot of research in order to understand this proverb, and I believe that I can explain it correctly. When I was a child, I had a lot of opportunity to listen to and witness many discussions between my grandfather and his friend, my teachers, and some unknown martial art masters. A couple of times, they talk about the term 分宗射箭 during their conversation. I was just a child back then. I could not understand what they were talking about, but I clearly remember them saying that 分宗射箭 is about the body structure in martial practice. Today, I'd like to share it with you. I don't want this information to disappear in the future, so let's preserve it. But first, let me ask you, have you seen any old photos of a Chinese archery? I will share some with you in this video later. In China, archery had thousands of years worth of history. It is said that archery was one of the most important military weapons in ancient China. It became a support only after firearms started dominating the battlefield. There have been many important military documents focusing on archery throughout Chinese history. For example, in the Tang Dynasty about 1,300 years ago, Wang Qu, a famous politician, military general, and a government official, wrote a book by the name Shi Jing, or Book of Archery. This book systematically introduced the basic training and the practice of archery. Then, about 700 years ago, during the Ming Dynasty, Li Chengfen published a book on archery by the same name, Shi Jing. But it contains a lot more detail than the previous book. Unfortunately, there is not a lot of information available about him today. By the way, I must acknowledge a very unfortunate and pitiable cultural phenomenon throughout much of Chinese history that many good documents do not contain detailed information of their authors, which makes research very hard. I will explain the reason for this phenomenon in the future. In Li Chengfen's book, he introduced an archery method in which the soldier holds the bow while on horseback. In order to shoot the arrow, the soldier holds the bow on the left side of the horseman and the right hand holds the bow, string, and arrow. So the horseman is the center line, intersecting the bow and arrow. This position gives the impression of the arrow parting the horseman. This is the reason why in ancient time, Chinese military people called this method 分宗射, or shooting while parting the horseman. By the way, some other military training manuals used the same term for describing this archery method. In my opinion, the best book about Chinese military archery is Wu Jing She Xue Zheng Zong, or Authentic Document of Archery Practice in Martial System by Gao Ying, published around 400 years ago. This topic is beyond the scope of this video. So, let's come back to the term 分宗射箭. So, what is the relationship between Chinese archery and the martial art posture? Well, before I answer this question, let me show you some more photos of Chinese archery. The people in those photos are shown wearing Qing Dynasty clothes. The Qing Dynasty ended in 1912. So, these photos are at least about 110 years old. Also, pay attention to their body structure, especially the lower back and hips. Now, do you notice a pattern in all these old photos? If you are very observant, you may have noticed that their lower back extended further backward, making their back diagonal instead of fully vertical. If you want, please go back to the photo section and watch that part again. Now, that should make you wonder, why is there body structure like that? In Li Chengfen's book of archery, he said that the correct posture for archery involves sinking down the waist and hips, making it look like the body extend forward. In practice, soldiers slightly extend their lower back slightly further backward and the upper body slightly extend forward. So the proverb 分宗射箭 in reality does not refer to the arms, neither to the bow nor to the arrow. It actually refers to the entire body structure. If you observe the soldier's structure from the side, it seems that his body leans slightly forward when opening the bow. Martial artist borrowed the idea of the body structure from archery in order to maximize the power released during application. Again, this proverb is used to describe the upper body leaning forward instead of being fully vertical. This body structure can be found very often in Xing Yi and Ba Guan. Especially in Xing Yi, we can see this kind of body structure everywhere. In all of the traditional practice of Xing Yi, all of the body structures apply this method. Some branches, like Xue Dian Xing Yi, emphasize this body method a lot more than the others. This is why in China, many people call this body structure Shi Zhan Jia or combat structure. In Tai Chi, we apply the same principle as well, even though it is very subtle or not as obvious as in Xing Yi or Ba Guan. Before we move on, let's see some of the old Xing Yi photos of Xue Dian so that you will understand the combat structure better. Again, this is the posture of Fen Zong She Jian, or part the horseman and shoot the arrow. In order to help my students understand and remember this term better, I appended a few words to this proverb. Instead of the original 分宗射箭, I now use the proverb 分宗射箭是前倾, or part the horseman shoot the arrow by leaning the body forward steadily. Please keep in mind that the leaning posture should be natural and not exaggerated, or else it will hinder the fa jin movements. Now, look at this picture. It's a painting done by a Western journalist back during the Qing Dynasty. Since the journalist did not know the correct body structure used in Chinese archery practice, this painting does not accurately depict Chinese archery practice. So far, you may have noticed an interesting pattern. Sometimes, a term literally used to describe one action is indeed used to describe another action. This proverb is the perfect example. At the same time, you should also realize that some of these terms are very misleading as it. So, going beyond the literal understanding is a key challenge in understanding the real meaning. I would like to share my personal experience. Years ago, some people belonging to younger martial generations than myself did not understand the reason for the forward-leaning approach in Xing Yi. For example, Xue Dian's forward-leaning posture. When they saw my video, some of them criticized my posture as being unstable. I responded by asking them, well, if you think my posture is unstable, then why is that I do not fall on the ground or lose balance during practice? Why is this that I can move fast? They developed a wrong impression of a body structure because of the widespread influence of modern wushu practice compared to traditional style back then. As a result of which many people forgot the traditional practice. Fortunately, traditional practice survived in China and received a lot of impetus about 30 years ago. Now, the traditional body structure of Xingyi practice is greatly comprehended and appreciated by the community, which is the result of many people's hard work in promoting the traditional art. I hope more and more people will understand and continue to preserve and promote the cultural and historical background of this practice in the future. By the way, there is a movement in Tai Chi called Ye Ma Fen Zong, or Wild Horse Separate Eight Men. Many people translate this term to parting the wild horse's mane. Many people even say that this movement literally involves parting the horse's mane with your hand. Actually, this is not correct. The correct translation is wild horse's mane parts itself. Since horse's mane naturally separate to both sides, there's no need to do it with your hands. Ye Ma Fen Zong in Tai Chi to practice the splitting force, and the force should be natural. Demonstration. To help you understand the Fen Zong Shi Jian Shi Qian Qing concept, I'd like to demonstrate an exercise so that you can practice this exercise by yourself. This is a natural posture forward punching movement used to practice releasing the force from the back. The key point here is to naturally lean your body forward steadily while using the lower back to initiate the power. It is also important to maintain an archery shooting posture after each fa jin movement. I'd like to show you one exercise that demonstrates the concept of a Fen Zong Shi Jian used in Fa Jin practice. So, you can keep this posture. So, in beginning, slowly, the body structure steadily lean forward. Then extend. Let me change the angle so that you'll be able to see the body better. So it's like this angle. Okay. Then you, at a certain point, you can put force. Let me change the angle again. I'm here. So take a ways. Quite a few additional proverbs released to the two main proverbs have been introduced in this video, some of which are my original contribution. The first main proverb is originally Qian Jiang Hou Sheng, which translated to downward from the front and upward from the back. Second, an accompanying proverb Kong Xiong Xia Qi, or empty the chest and sinking down the energy. Third, a second accompanying proverb is Hou Bei Ti Jin, or raise up energy from the back. Four, I appended two additional phrases to the original proverb Qian Jiang Hou Sheng. The first phrase is Jiang Yi Hu Xi, which means that the downward motion of the front part of the body is achieved through breathing. Five, the second phrase is Sheng Yi Ti Ding, means that The upward motion of the back part of the body is achieved through raising up the top of the head area. 6. So the complete proverb thus become 前降后升，降以呼吸，升以涕零。 7th, the second main proverb I talked about was originally 分鬃射箭 or separate the horsemen and shoot the arrow. 8th, my extension to that proverb now makes it 分鬃射箭是前倾 or separate the horsemen shoot the arrow by leaning the body forward slightly. I'm aware that this video will leave many of you confused. But don't worry, the concept explained in this video will become clearer to you with sufficient time and practice. So, I advise you to visit this video at regular intervals to examine your own progress and improvement in understanding. That's end today's video. Thank you for watching. See you next time and enjoy your practice.